I don't have any answers, just some questions. Who's going to win the Oscar for best actor? Was Bush sedated at that press conference? When innocent people die, is it worse than when the guilty do? Guilty of what? Can you define dry drunk? Are you tired, as I am, of these right-wing fundamentalists trying to reverse what little progress we've managed to make in our attempts to create, as Che once said, a world where love is more possible? Are some kids more precious than others? If some white folks build a housing complex on an Indian reservation with money from white supremacists, and they use the few resources the reservation has to make their housing project bigger and better than the Native American houses, and some of the Native Americans demonstrate against this, and the response of our government is to build a barbed wire fence around the white enclave and send soldiers to man watchtowers and protect the whites, and this pisses the Native Americans off, and the demonstrations get rowdy, and some Indian kids throw rocks at the soldiers, and the soldiers shoot and kill some of these kids, and the Indians get even more upset and vow to stop the settlements and get the whites off their land, and some try to fight, but to no avail, since the weapons are no match for the overwhelming power of our government forces, and this only makes the Indians madder, and our government sends in more soldiers with tanks and armor and builds more settlements for more white people, and then an Indian comes up with a way to build a bomb that you have to be willing to kill yourself to detonate, and a young Indian volunteers and blows himself up along with some innocent whites, including children, and the response of our government is to bulldoze into oblivion the house of his family and some of their neighbors' houses too, and a pregnant young Indian woman is crushed by a falling wall because the soldiers told her family to stay inside, and then the soldiers take over the reservation and won't let the Indians go out to get food or go to work, and if they do go out during curfew, some of them are shot and killed. Who would be the innocent ones in all that, and the guilty? Is that question anti-Semitic? What's going to win the Oscar for Best Picture? Do you have to have Irish ancestors who came over around the time of the gangs in New York to leave that film not dismissive of the dumbed-down Hollywood plot or the mostly inappropriate Hollywood casting, but instead overwhelmed with shock and rage and a deep, inarticulate sadness? Do my relatives in uniform support Bush because the right-wing fundamentalists are really that good at manipulating the media, a media mostly owned by them, but which they continue to attack as liberal in order to debunk any questioning of their tactics and actions by the small percentage of media outlets that are halfway independent of them? You call this a poem? Are the Arabs to blame for their problems? Are Native Americans, are Irish Catholics in Northern Ireland, are the Tutus, the North Koreans, Patty Hearst, Muhammad Ali, Chris Reeves, the Jews, the Tibetans, Southern Baptists, Hollywood, Wall Street, Enron, Ford, Maria Carey, Crispin Glover, the Catholic priesthood, the Chechens, the Colombians, the troops in Kuwait and Iraq, are we? What makes me think I can wait till the last minute to write a poem about how humbled I am by the idea that poetry can do anything to stop the carnage anywhere, except in our hearts, however briefly? Wasn't I the only veteran on that stage the night in 1966 when I took part in my first anti-war poetry reading? If Bush wins in Iraq and Osama is caught and the economy rebounds enough to give people some hope, is his re-election inevitable? Is it inevitable anyway? Should those who voted for Nader be forced to apologize to the innocent victims of Bush's policies? Or for his renewed attack on the environment in the hypocritical but seemingly successful guise of a man who actually cares about clean air? Why are Democrats who are smart enough and tough enough and good enough politicians to play hardball with the right-wing pricks so rare? Do we only care about war and the innocent lives it takes when Americans are at risk? Isn't it obvious that wars never end, they just move? What good did our pointing out that Malcolm X and Martin Luther King were only assassinated after they stopped talking about race and began talking about class and the rights of poor people do? Isn't it obvious these right-wing fundamentalists are still pissed off about what FDR did for working folk with Social Security and tried to do with health care and other programs that they've since managed to dismantle or are still attempting to? Isn't it ironic how much they hate Carter for being a true Christian and showing them up for the hypocrites they are? Do these right-wing fundamentalists really believe that the founding fathers were born-again Christians who believe, like Bush, that only they'll go to heaven when the rapture comes, when the framers of the Constitution barely believed in organized religion at all and none took the Bible literally? If the right-wing fundamentalists really believe we should all follow the Bible's directions, why wasn't Newt Gingrich buried in sand up to his neck and stoned to death when he cheated on his first wife with his second, and then on his second with his third? Can you get more hypocritical than to try and impeach a president for adulterous sex with an intern when you're doing the same exact thing at the same exact time? Is it true even Newt thinks this attack on Iraq is ill-conceived? Ever notice how much Bush Jr. looks like his cousin Prince Charles with the same shaped faces and big ears and those long straight noses and beady eyes and thin lipped superior smirks, though Charles is better trained to hide his? Is it any wonder Jr. acts like he rules by divine right when he obviously does? Isn't it as though the American Revolution has been reversed without a fight? As the vast right-wing conspiracy triumphed at last with an almost complete takeover by an alcoholic spoiled brat with a right-wing Christian fundamentalist makeover? Isn't there good and evil, there, you're either with us or against us thing like a drink to a dry drunk on an imperial binge? In the past, wasn't the vast right-wing conspiracy always on the wrong side of history? For the king, against the revolution, for slavery, against the eight-hour day, for child labor and Jim Crow segregation, against votes for women, for legal discrimination, against immigrants and Catholics, Hispanics and African Americans, for treating corporations like privileged individuals and individuals like corporate privileges? Or is history still on their side with that one, as corporate power grows and equality slows, at least the kind based on the chance to make a living? Isn't it true that during the fabulous fucked up 50s, they pretend to be so nostalgic for they ignore the part about how ordinary citizens won the war and came home to a nation tired of depression and built unions strong enough to give a working man a chance to own a home and keep up with the Joneses, if not the Walkers and Bushes? Wasn't the difference between liberal capitalists and conservative capitalists summed up best by JFK's old man during the Depression when he said he was willing to give up half of what he had to keep the other half, while the conservatives aren't willing to give up anything? Wasn't the first thing they protected after 9/11 offshore banking at headquarters for corporations and wealthy individuals to avoid paying the taxes the rest of us do, even if that's how and where the terrorists and drug barons hide their money too? Wasn't the next thing they bailed out the airlines because of all the fuel they use and anything that helps make unconscionable profits for oil companies is their first priority? Isn't it true that their oil corporate patrons wanted to run a pipeline through Afghanistan, but the Taliban wouldn't let them, and now the new Afghan government will? Didn't the CIA overthrow the democratically elected leader of Iran in 1953 with the help of a Nazi collaborator who immediately set up 25-year leases on Iran's oils for three U.S. firms, including Gulf Oil? Didn't Kermit Roosevelt, the CIA head of that region, retire shortly thereafter to a vice presidency of Gulf Oil? Didn't the CIA back the coup that overthrew the democratically elected president of 1950s Guatemala because of his proposal to nationalize some of the United Fruit's vast holdings? Didn't Walter Bedell Smith, the CIA man in charge, within a year become a member of the board of directors of, you guessed it, the United Fruit Company? Does anyone see echoes of that today in Cheney's connections to Halliburton or Bush's to Enron? Isn't it true that this shit has been going on forever? Isn't it also true that our government, which usually means one of the secret agencies with secret funding for which the Constitution never allowed, trained and paid the leaders of Al-Qaeda in the Afghan proxy war with the Soviets, as well as supplied the necessary ingredients for Saddam's method, weapons of mass destruction, including the gas he used against the Kurds and the helicopters to transport it? And that Bush and his cohorts, including his wife, never mentioned the ways the Taliban oppressed women or Saddam killed his own people until it was convenient politically, and still don't talk about how daddy's cohorts and business partners in Saudi Arabia have links to Osama and his movement and oppressed women and all the other atrocities dictatorships and oligarchies have been committing with our government's blessings throughout our history. You call this poetry? When Bush Sr. offered to get rid of America's chemical arsenal, didn't he mean only the already old and leaking and no longer feasible ones the U.S. had stockpiled, and not the new, improved, and even deadlier ones it kept on making? Doesn't the link between the CIA and drug smuggling go back to its beginnings? In fact, can't you track which country the CIA is trying to get something from or do something to by which drug is the latest epidemic? Hasn't the killing of innocent civilians always been a tactic in war from biblical times through Dresden and Hiroshima to Vietnam and El Salvador or Kosovo and the Congo? Aren't we all going to die? Are we obsessed with the denial of that reality? Or is that just me because I've seen a lot of people pass or die, as you might say, from one thing or another, including my mother, in a way that seemed unfair and certainly unnecessary and arbitrary and cruel? But what death isn't? Those I remember that were no surprise, though devastating anyway, or now you see me, now you never will again, finality. Is that why now it's life I'm obsessed with? Or is that because when I watched the second plane crash into the second tower on TV, a thin blue tube hung from my urethra, attached to a clear plastic bag, the remnant of a cancer operation the week before, unaware an old friend was on that flight at that moment, incinerated, a woman who was kind to me when she didn't need to be and always treated me with respect and affection? How many people have died before you got the chance to tell them what you meant to? Does it seem there's not enough sometimes because it's too much? Haven't I said and written more than once that poetry saved my life, did it for you? Wasn't it the only thing that could stop the war in my heart and head over where I thought I was being led by the clan and neighborhood and extended family of cops I was born into at the beginning of another war, when the prognosis was bleak for our side, and when the tide turned and with it went the country's Great Depression? Didn't that war save us from ourselves, create a new economy and ways to milk it? Didn't my oldest brothers join the service out of high school before it was all over, though it's never all over, as the newsreels and Life magazine made clear to even my developing child's perception? But isn't our part in it often hidden until later events like those in Korea drag us in ways even civilians can't ignore? Didn't my other brother get drafted during that war? But didn't the only one of our clan who saw real combat, my favorite cousin Jackie, always have a joke to make you grin until I pestered him to let me in on what war was like up close, and he kept putting me off until he'd had enough and then spat out how he was scared his whole time there, and when he faced the enemy, he shot into the air like he was sure they did too, then he got as far from them as he could. Is that why they don't have the draft anymore? Is it because I didn't want to have my boyhood fantasies destroyed that I convinced myself he was just kidding again, sparing me the gory details? Decades later, didn't scholars of war research Korean battlefields and determine by the angle of the bullets they found buried in the ground that most rounds had to have been fired into the air? Do we really care who wins the little gold statuette in La La Land, especially this year? Not long after the Korean War ended, wasn't I one of a street corner doo-wop quartet of pale-faced budding Irish alcoholics called the Four Roses? And didn't red-headed Moose Conlon, the youngest but biggest, later step on a mine in Vietnam? Isn't that his name on a boulder in the park in the Jersey town where we played ball when we weren't singing? Isn't it true the world hasn't been easy for a long time? Wasn't it once? Weren't there kids, little girls in dresses with skinny legs and bare arms, and boys too shy to make as much noise as the others, under street lamps, out late because it's too warm to go to bed yet, and nothing good for kids on the radio anyway, and nobody really afraid of anything too strange and disturbing to threaten their hopes for more evenings like this? Wasn't the world easy once? Wasn't that because we didn't know and maybe didn't want to, like my nephews and nieces don't today, as they sail away to foreign ports, called up in the reserves or on the active duty they see as a way out of the confusion of a working class that thinks it isn't, or that class doesn't matter, at least not in the talk radio they listen to? Is there no other way for them to go? Isn't that all they know, despite my talks and books and emails? Don't they say it worked for me? It's how I got out into the world when I try to tell them why they're wrong to believe their leaders and the right-wing corporate radio pimps. Isn't it difficult for them to see, as it was for me when I used the GI Bill to attend a university that filled my head with information that made me dizzy, made me crazy, made me feel alienated from all I'd known and grown to love the further away I got from it? Shit, why didn't anybody tell us when we beat the lousy Krauts and stinking Japs that the man who would later get us to the moon, Wernher von Braun, was the same Nazi scientist who made the rockets that rained down death on London? Did any poem of Dylan Thomas ever tell me that? Who knew the Volkswagen Beetle that the college kids and later lefties would embrace was Hitler's idea? Did anyone ever discuss how we obliterated Dresden for no strategic reason or caused more civilian death, is that true, and devastation there than in the firebombing of Tokyo than with the atom bombs we dropped? Why didn't I know that General Electric got off with a fine and hand slap for colluding with the Nazis, or that IBM set up the Nazis' record-keeping, or that we refused to bomb the railroad tracks that carried the freight cars full of Jews to their destination? Can we guess why our bombs never touched the Krupp arms factory? Is it because it isn't freedom or democracy we fight for or defend, but in the end it's weapons, fuel, and drugs, the trinity that underpins the wealth of nations and the corporations that rule them? Did you know the company that makes the new computerized voting machines that defied the exit polls and put right-wing Republicans in power in the Senate where they weren't before are owned by the right-wing Republican senator who did just that in Nebraska, where according to the results even a majority of blacks who said they voted against them were obviously wrong and did the opposite according to his computers? Is that why the networks won't use their own exit polls anymore, so as not to contradict machines that leave no inconvenient paper trail that can be verified, no tabs and chads and all the rest that almost gave us who we really voted for? Why would my relatives in uniform or not want to know that, stifling in the embrace of a fate much bigger than any whim of Bush the Great as he seems to see himself? And why shouldn't he? Didn't he grow up with the kind of privileges our families couldn't even guess at? When I went AWOL for a two-week unplanned vacation in San Francisco of 1962, didn't I come back to a court-martial on its consequences? When he failed to show up for weekend duty in the Texas National Guard during Vietnam for an entire year, didn't he get the same pass he got when reporters let him gas about how DUIs at 40 are just youthful indiscretions, not the job-losing experience they might be for you or me or our families? But he never had a job to lose, did he? Weren't they just favors from his father's friends? And even when he lost them, didn't somebody else pay the price, as we are doing now this night, especially those paid peanuts to fight in his place once again? But is it a whim or divine right in his sight, as he's implied? Have you noticed how he never mangles his speech when he talks about bending others to his will, about killing prisoners in death Texas on death row, or blowing those he's designated evil to kingdom come? Can you see that he's not dumb, just not a very good liar, stumbling over words meant to convey compassion or all the things he knows aren't true? Wasn't it odd when he defended himself at his recent news conference by explaining with exasperation that his reason for waging war in Iraq was because, as he emotionally explained, as though to remedial students, he put his hand on a Bible and took an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States of America? Has Saddam got plans for destroying our Constitution? Would that be by enticing Bush into an alliance-breaking terrorist inciting preemptive attack on a large source of oil? Is that too glib? When American troops found al-Qaeda training videos in Afghanistan, weren't they right to be incensed at the tactics being practiced by these Muslim boys and men against pretend hostages they might take in an assault on Ohio or Dubuque, as the trainees screamed and punched and kicked their innocent victim monks? Just like the Afghan taxi driver said was done to him by American women and men interrogating him about things he had no knowledge of while chained to the ceiling and floor, like some New Yorker cartoon that isn't funny anymore? Wasn't it the blows and kicks meted out by an American female that made the Afghan cry, the humiliation of it, as he pissed his pants and cowered under the physical and verbal abuse for no more reason, he claimed, than that he drove his taxi into the wrong street at the obviously wrong time? Didn't he also cry at the memory of the Afghan boys who died in the custody of our interrogators, never having been away from their families and home before, their being chained to ceiling and floor at ankle and wrist while being deprived of sleep and screamed at in an English they couldn't decipher? Didn't the military doctors who did their autopsies with the same efficient record-keeping that the Nazis perfected say they died of internal injuries? Am I saying the gang who tried to permanently eliminate Jews and gypsies and queers and the retarded and deformed and more is what our troops and their commanders replicate in our name? Or am I saying war brings out the best and worst of, but haven't you heard all that before? Aren't your souls and hearts as sore as mine from all the confusion and obfuscation and distortion and repulsion of what others do to others in the name of having been done to us? Didn't our government use the same tactics it deplored Saddam for? Didn't we try to be honest? But didn't the truth keep changing on us? When I was a kid, didn't they teach us that Uncle Joe Stalin helped us win the war? When I was a man, didn't Ronald Reagan remember scenes from war movies as if they really happened? And he was there, though he was in Hollywood the entire time, making movies he remembered as reality? In the light of his later disease, don't we understand that? Don't we understand everything sometimes or once? Is this the way we count the time to go to get to where we know we'll be all right for us again? Or have we walked through the door to the future and found ourselves on fire before we can see the flames, and what remains and what must go is all these fools are fighting over when they pose as people in the know on where we all have been and might be going? Does it matter where we are, the color of our skin or religion of our ancestors, or is that incidental? Because what's fundamental about these times is the way the long hot summer starts in winter, one unexpected day, and then say turns up in spring for more than a week, or peaks in fall when all we want is a breath of fresh, crisp air, the kind we find some mornings in the mountains or the north, but not as many as before the earth became a living, dying litmus test of our deceit in dealing with these tired times when even trees are gasping to survive, and they're the ones who keep us alive. How much does the changing weather patterns over Afghanistan that caused the years of drought that impoverished the country that embraced the Taliban solution to their problems have to do with lives lost and the other costs of 9/11? What legacy do we end with? Too many VCRs and DVDs and not enough of what it takes to keep us all from baking in the long hot summer of a race's demise, despite the seemingly old-fashioned winter we've just survived? Is it a surprise that the fate we share is in the air, not in the eyes of some tenacious politician who pretends he's one of us? Was Duchamp correct when he said, only in French, tools that are no good require more skill? Isn't it too noisy these days? Can you hear yourself think with all these hard surfaces reflecting the clatter of all the shit that doesn't even matter anymore? Can't we just close the door? Does it help to lock it, bolt it, reinforce it with armed guards and VCRs and liposuction and cost reduction and all the seduction your memory can muster? Is it still too noisy in here? Out there, is that the smell of blood and fire in the air? Has the star that led us here disappeared over the horizon while we're still waiting for something else to happen as if we hadn't had enough already? Haven't I too felt like beating or bombing someone who frightened me or pissed me off because of the way they looked or acted or seemed to be? Can't we all just get along? Don't you want to believe we can? But when your friends are turning up with lies and alibis for all their sadness and depression, and the recession is supposed to be ending just when your money's running out, and they keep smoking and slamming and jabbing themselves with ways to deform what they can't even accept yet, what are we doing here anyway? Am I wrong? Was I always? Is it not about healing, but about tearing each other's eyes out because we don't see things the same way? Is it all about blame? We're all alive and depend on the ocean and trees and the air they give us to breathe. So what are we doing? Going to any lengths to rip each other off and tear each other down? Has the smoke gone away or not? Because it isn't from the flames, but from the fire that only burns our lungs like marshmallows at the camps we never went to. Too busy getting here where there is no air we can't see, and the fee for being cynical like I'm feeling tonight is to get up tomorrow and fight my way into a breath I can remember before this war and all our simple dreams of harmony got started. Aren't you feeling brokenhearted too these days, but not like you lost a lover, like you're losing the sustainers of your soul and very breath? Can't we do something about it? Can't we all just get along, as in people and trees and animals and seas and the breeze that will someday stop if we don't start letting it all go or never stop? The hurt and the hate and the need to forget it with stuff that just adds to the noise and pollution. Isn't there only one life and one problem and one solution, from the streets to the elite? Don't we all have a seat in this universe we share? Is ours now at the feet of the oil oligarchy running what once was our home? You call this a poem? Didn't they used to say the best things in life are free when they meant the air and the trees and the sea? But we know better now, don't we? When death is no longer imaginary, doesn't it all seem like poetry? Or is that just me?